Thomas Cocking, Richard Stevens, John Cocking, William Barber, John Thomas, Matthew Barber, and Edgar Bassett.
He knocked the door and shouted, "There's not one moment to lag." By then the door was opened and there stood the coxswain and son Jack. I knew at once his errand. I knew there was a ship in distress. So I shouted, "I'm coming, boy," as I ran to my bedroom to dress. When I reached the boathouse, the people by then were few. But Tommy Cocking was running to summon the rest of the crew. The coxswain then blew his whistle, and as they pulled her along, there appeared around the corner the signalman, young John. With Matthew and William Barber, they all stood around the boat. The two of the crew were absent. There weren't enough to go afloat. The coxswain jumped from the lifeboat, and making it plain and clear, he shouted to those around him, asking for a volunteer. Freeman and Bassett responded, and quickly they took their place, knowing full well the danger they were about to face. Now every man stood at his post, and Stevens, the engineer, shouted, all ready, to the coxswain, as the engine clutched in the gear. Hundreds stood watching the lifeboat as she passed the pier headlight to face the open Atlantic on a wild and stormy night. The night rolled on, we watched, we waited, still no news from the boat. It's time we heard from them now, Bill. It's 3 hours since they've been afloat. Little groups like this were talking from the boathouse down to the pier. Anxious looks were on their faces as they talked in dread and fear. The news soon flashed throughout the town at approximately 6:54 that fate had overtaken the lifeboat. She's aground on the eastern shore. Rescuers were quickly rushed along to the scene of the wreck, only to find the lifeboat with a shattered deck. Only one left to tell the tale, how from the wreckage he reached the shore, to scale the cliffs so rugged and steep, to find a cottage across the moor. He told his story, though weary and faint, how they were all swept by the tide, as wave after wave turned over the boat, flinging his shipmates from his side. Just one word to the mourner, listen to what Jesus said. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And if that call should come again from someone unknown to you, would you not follow in the trail and find with others a crew? We'll ever remember that fateful morn when 8 brave men left the port of St Ives. Think of the tragedy. Think of that loss, for 7 paid dear by giving their lives. They paid the supreme sacrifice. They paid it right to the end. For greater love have no man than to lay down his life for his